from tape, CDs, DVDs to our publication, Voices from Zexant Glory, Declaring the Kingdom. Right, P.O. Box 21516, Hot Springs, Arkansas, zip 71903. Our website is www.LakeHamiltonBibleCamp.com and LHBCOnline.com. There are hundreds of free audio files there. It's like going to Bible school at home.
Monday morning, May the 26th, 1986. Final service of the Memorial Weekend Teaching and Deliverance Seminar being held at Lake Hamilton Bible Campgrounds, Hot Springs National Park, Arkansas. Tommy Cook is the minister of the morning.
It's been a privilege to have you all, and
Amen.
For Tommy and Bill and Peggy to be here with us, and the other ministers, and
yes.
All of you, and all of them. Amen. Amen. But you know, Tommy is just belongs here with us.
Mm-hmm.
He just belongs here, and he'll just do whatever, wherever he's needed. He's willing, and he doesn't get his feelings hurt about things.
Amen.
And we just appreciate Tommy and the ministry God's given him, and the ministry that and the blessing that he is and is yet to be across the nation.
Amen.
God's
right.
Got a ministry for him that's going to reach across the nation.
That's right. That's exactly
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
And we're happy that we can be a part of Brother Tommy and Brother Bill's ministry.
Amen.
We bless them, and we love them.
Amen.
Come on, Brother Cook.
Thank you, Brother Glenn. Praise the Lord. Let's stand together. Praise the Lord. Father, again today, we do thank you for everything you've done, Lord, in this camp. We thank you again for this word, Lord. It's our life today, Lord. And God, we thank you for the life that flows from the throne of God. Lord, we thank you for the anointing of your spirit that is upon your word today, Lord. And Lord, we just ask again that you give us open hearts, Lord, to receive the word of God, Lord. We thank you. Jesus, you said, except we eat your flesh and drink your blood, we have no life in us. And so, Lord, we thank you for that life today that we can partake of, Lord. And bless us, encourage us, Lord. And God, as we go our separate ways today, give us a safe journey on the highways, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. We want you to pray for us as we leave here. Don't forget to pray for us. We encourage people to pray for me and Bill, because we do travel a lot together and go places. And we encourage you to pray for us. One time, years ago, I was praying in Oklahoma, and I had my hands raised. It was on a Sunday afternoon, and when I did, God spoke to me, and he said, you will go to this nation. That's the words he said to me. And it was confirmed, of course, by another brother in a vision he had. But, you know, to go out. Paul said there was an effectual door, but there were many adversaries. And, you know, don't think when the ministers go out, they're just having a good time. They're also battling, too, and wrestling and fighting. Amen. They're helping others as the Lord helps them, but sometimes they're going through hard places. And many times we go through those things that Irma was talking about a while ago, and it gets pretty tough. But we believe God's given us intercessors to pray for us. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Turn today in your Bible to Exodus chapter 33. We'll look at a few scriptures here today together. And I thank God that we've got to come again this time and be part of the camp. Exodus chapter 33. I love to teach the Word of God. And I know when I can teach and give out, God gives back to me.
Yes.
And we should be givers of whatever God puts in our hands. But in Exodus 33, verse 13, we can't do it without Him, though. Now, therefore, I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, Moses is speaking to God, show me now thy way. Anybody want to know the ways of God?
Amen.
Amen. I do too. That I may know thee. Show me thy way that I may know thee. So to know God's ways is to know Him. Not just know about Him, but to know Him. That I may find grace in thy sight. And consider this nation is thy people. Now, Moses was the leader of the people, but Moses said, God, it's really your people. But he said, I want grace. And I want to know your way. And in verse 14, I'm just kind of going through some of these scriptures to bring you to where we're going to. He said in verse 14, my presence shall go with thee. This is what the Lord told Moses. And I will give thee rest. My margin says peace. And he said to him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. Well, that's the way I feel. Without the presence of God, you can't do anything, can you? You know, you might as well just sit down and do nothing. I mean, if God's not in it. Verse 17, and the Lord said to Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. And he said, now look at this, Moses said in verse 18, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Anybody ever prayed that? Anybody here ever prayed that? Show me thy glory. Hallelujah. In verse 19, the Lord says, okay, my goodness is going to pass before you. In verse 20, you can't see my face. No man can see me and live. Verse 21, God said, there's a place by me. You'll stand upon the rock. How many know the rock is Christ? 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and it shall come to pass while my glory passes by. You're not going to stand only on that rock, but I will put thee in the cliff of the rock that's in Christ, that's hid in Christ, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I'm going to take away my hand, God said, and I'm going to let you see my back parts. That's the afterglow, but my face shall not be seen. Now, chapter 34, look at verse 2. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mountain. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herds feed before the mount. Now right here, God said, if you want to see my glory, there's going to be inspection time. And it's a command that you come up, and notice it's in the morning, it's the dawning of a new day. But I want to give you 4 points that I see here. Number one, God said to Moses, be ready in the morning. To be ready is to be prepared. Isn't that right? If you're ready, you're prepared. And God said to him, be ready in the morning. Be prepared in the morning. And then he said, come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai. Come up in the morning to Mount Sinai. And notice, present thyself there to me. So he said to him, be ready, come up, present yourself. And then in verse 3, he said, no man will come up with thee. How many know we're in this thing? Of course, we're in it together. But individually, we have a responsibility to seek the Lord for our own spiritual welfare. Isn't that right? You can't do it for your brother, and you can't do it for your sister. You do it for yourself. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. But God said, no man shall come up with thee. Now look at this. Neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount. I mean, no man's been seen long enough.
Amen.
So if you're going to see the glory of God, you're going to be ready. You're going to be prepared. And you're going to begin to ascend in God. But you're going to have to present yourself to God. No man's going to be with you. You're coming, you and your God together. Hallelujah. And you're not going to be seen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, let's look at this preparation. I want to turn you to a few scriptures here a minute. Turn to Isaiah 62. We want to look at 3 scriptures here that's kind of together right now. Isaiah 62. There is preparation. Praise the Lord. And we want to look at verse 10. 62:10. Go through the That's the command. How many gates are there? 12 gates. 12 is the number of government. And God said here, go through the gates. Prepare ye the way of the people. There's the way. There's the word prepare. Prepare ye the way of the people. Now, I believe that speaks of the overcomers. Because the overcomers will go through the 12 gates. They'll have those 12 experiences in God. And when they have overcome and come through those experiences, they will be matured in the Lord. And they will be like Him. Amen? And He said, prepare ye the way of the people. The overcomer or the mighty ones are preparing a way. Just as Jesus went first and has prepared a way for us. Amen? I mean, no, He was the forerunner that entered through the veil first. And yet God is raising a people up that's also going to prepare the way for people. Prepare ye the way of the people. Cast up the highway. The highway is the highway of holiness, clean living before God. Gather out the stones. That's a purging, isn't it? And lift up a standard for the people. What's the standard? The standard is Jesus lifted up through the people by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Now turn to Isaiah 26. Isaiah 26. And in verse, let's read three verses here. Verse 1, 2, and 3. Verse 2 is the verse we want, but we'll read three scriptures. In that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah, in the land of praise. We have a strong city. Well, how many know there's a strong city coming forth? The church. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks. Open ye the gates. Open ye the gates. That the righteous nation, and that's the holy nation that Peter spoke about, that the righteous nation which keeps what? The truth may enter in. That's another clue. If we have truth, we keep it. Otherwise, we practice it. We do it. We enter into the gates. Amen? And look at the next verse. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. Now turn to Revelation 21. Hallelujah. Or 22. Revelation 22, 14. Oh, I've taught this scripture so many places and so many times with other scriptures. I love it. It's one of my in the New Testament. And I'll tell you, there's a message. You get this message right here, this word in this one verse in you with other scriptures, and it'll do something on the inside of you. But in Revelation 22:14, blessed are they that do. And we are doers of the word, not just hearers. Amen. The kingdom is not in word but in power, but we practice that power. We practice that word. Blessed are they that do his commandments. What is the commandments? It's the words. It's the sayings of God. Amen? Yes, that's right. That's it. That's good. I believe it. It's all that God has said. Amen? And so, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they, the ones that keep the commandments, that they may have a right or the privilege or the authority. And we believe he's given us authority. Why has he given us authority? Because we do his commandments. We do what he says. Amen? How many know he can trust those that do his word? That they, of course, he's given that authority to us. God has given that to us. That they may have a right or the authority to the tree of life, and they may enter in through the gates into the city. Hallelujah. How many gates are there? 12 gates. What's each gate made of? Pearls. What's pearl speaks of? Suffering. And you enter the gate, you enter suffering. Isn't that right? I mean, no, through much tribulation, we must enter what? The kingdom of God. Amen? Now, how many know we need to know what suffering really is? There's some suffering, you know, that's not, we don't have to handle, I think. How many know that Jesus did not have sickness and disease, and yet we have to fight that thing in ourselves, don't we? Isn't that right? But there is real suffering, though. And some of the suffering is right here in our flesh. How many know somebody does you wrong and you know, says something about you or just does you wrong? You know, that old flesh wants to rip and just hit him in the nose. Isn't that right? Or her in the nose or whatever. But how many know you can just come to a place in God where you just say, I'm not coming out. I'm not going to get angry. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to love. How many know there is a suffering to that old flesh? And Paul talked about the suffering that's within. Amen? How many's ever seen that? Amen. All right. Now, so we see here that blessed are those that do the commandments, that they have a right to the tree of life. Now turn to chapter 2. We'll see who they are real quick, and then we'll go back to the Old Testament. Revelation 2:7. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of what? The tree of life. Now, he said if we kept the commandments, we could enter through the gates of the city, and we had a right or the privilege or the authority to what? The tree of life. Right here he said, those that overcome, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Now, that is not something way out there. That is something we're learning to partake of today. Amen. Isn't that right? As we overcome. Now, some people are headed off from the tree of life because they're not overcoming. He said to the one that overcomes, he'll be able to enter the gates. He'll be able here, rather, to partake of the tree of life. Isn't that right? All right. So we can see those that do that are the overcomers. Now, let's go back. Let's go to Revelation 19 now. About about being prepared, being ready. Amen? Be ready in the morning, God said. Now, Revelation 19, look at 7, 8, and 9. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to Him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and His wife hath made herself ready. Who made herself ready? His wife. Who's the wife? The bride of Christ. It's the city that comes down, amen, out of God. How many know that's Revelation 21? How many know He's not married to a physical carnal city? He's married to a chaste virgin of people, isn't He? All right, verse 8. And to her, the bride, amen, was granted that she should be arrayed or dressed in fine linen, clean and white. How many know that's the covering of the overcomer there? And for the fine linen is the righteous acts of saints. And He said to me, write, blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And He said to me, these are the true things of God. And that word supper there, I mean, you know, the word sup comes from that word right there. Jesus said, I will come into Him and sup. It's from this word, supper. It means to dine out, have an evening meal or a feast with Him. And how many know when He comes in, there is a feast. There is an intimacy with Jesus. We're not talking about sitting down for steak and potatoes. We're talking about having a relationship with Jesus. Amen? All right, now turn to Matthew 25. Matthew 25. We're just on this first point, being ready. Matthew 25, look at verse 6. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go you out to meet him. And all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. And the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us or you, but go you rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were what? Ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. I believe that's the first fruit company right there. And the door was slammed, it was shut at that particular time. Praise the Lord. But they that were ready went in. Noah and his family was ready, and they went in. And God shut the door, and right here the door shut. Amen? But they were ready. Praise the Lord. Now, in this chapter, how many know that the Lord gives three stories or three parables, call them what you want to, about the kingdom? And I'll just tell you quickly, on the negative, there were five that were unprepared. There was one who did not reproduce, and there were those who did not perceive. I'll say that again. Three P's. There was those who were not prepared, you know. There was those who did not produce. And there were those who did not perceive. But on the positive, there was five prepared. There was those who did produce. And there were those who perceived in the three stories He gave there. All right. So we can see. Let's go back now to Exodus. Now where we were. I want to go back. I don't want to lose our thought now. Exodus 34. And again, I want to look at the scripture. In chapter 34, verse 2, He said to Moses, if you want to see my glory, be ready in the morning. Be prepared in the morning. How many know, again, the morning speaks of a dawning of a new day? And brothers and sisters, there is a new day dawning on the horizon. Isn't that right? And there's a new people for a new day with a new diet that's being prepared for the next age. Hallelujah. But He said, be ready in the morning and come up in the morning. Very important that you see that. Be ready in the morning and come up in the morning. Okay? Because we're going to see that word morning again in just a minute. Unto Mount Sinai, and present yourself to me, Moses, in the top of the mount. No man's going to come with thee now, and no man is going to be seen. Praise His name. Hallelujah. Now, turn with me to another scripture, if you will, this time. Let's go to Exodus 19. Exodus 19. Hallelujah. Exodus 19, look at verse 10. And the Lord said unto Moses, how many know Moses means to be drawn out? In every place and everywhere in his life, he was drawn out, wasn't he? Out of the water as a baby in the little basket, out of Pharaoh's courts behind the desert, up to Mount Sinai, into the wilderness, up to Mount Nebo and died. And the Lord said to Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud. That's verse 9, verse 10. The Lord said to Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today, and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Verse 11, and be what?
Ready.
And be ready against the what?
Third day.
How many believe we're coming to the third day? I'm going to get on that in just a minute. For the third day, the Lord will come down. Hallelujah. When's the Lord coming down? Amen. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people. Now, let's look at this just a minute. Turn to, from Adam to the millennium, is as a day with the Lord is how long? And 1,000 years as a day. So 7 days we're dealing with, aren't we? From Adam to the into the millennium. Now, look in Psalms 90 just a minute. Look in Psalms 90. And look at verse 4. Now, 2 Peter 3 tells us that the day with the Lord is as 1,000 years and so forth. Now, in Psalms 90, verse 4, look at this. 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday. Well, what was yesterday? It was a day. It is past, and as a watch in the night. So he said 1,000 years in thy sight is but yesterday. So that shows us that Pentecost was just day before yesterday in God's sight. Amen? 2 days. Now, turn to Joshua chapter 1, verse 11. Joshua 1, verse 11. How many has ever studied the book of Joshua? Hallelujah. Amen? Thank the Lord. Praise the Lord. How many know one of the greatest miracles in the book of Joshua is getting all the people going the same direction? Amen? All stand quiet. Till it's time for them to what? Shout. Amen. Now, look in Joshua 1:11. Pass through the host and command the people, saying, prepare you victuals, or victuals, I call them. For within 3 days, you shall do something. You're going to pass over this Jordan. Now, is he talking to one man or to a company of people? He's talking to a body, isn't he?
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. And I believe God's taking a body in together. How about you? He said to this people, you shall pass over this Jordan. And going across Jordan speaks of course, to us the rending of the veil. It's going from the holy place to the holy of holies. And notice, go in and possess the land which the Lord your God gives you to possess it. It's not enough to enter. You've got to conquer it and you have to possess it. And how many know there's warfare involved? Amen. No, it isn't. You've got to kick the giants off of your inheritance and out of you too. Amen. But notice, in 3 days, now here God brought them right up to the banks of Jordan. And this time the Jordan had overflowed, with a flood. And there was nowhere in the natural they were going to cross that Jordan. So there was a helpless, hopeless situation right here in the natural. And God made them camp there and look at that for 3 days. Amen. And I can hear the carnal mind saying, well, we'll build a few boats and go across. No. How many know they went across, though, when the thing split? God took them across. In when? 3 days. Amen. Now, Adam, we know, in the first day that was created back there, Adam lived almost a day, didn't he? Not quite 1,000 years. And we know that God made a distinction and a difference there with the seed in the beginning of the seed of Christ, the woman's seed, and the seed of the serpent. Isn't that right? God made a division right there. In the first day, and then in the the true seed was in Adam and Eve when God created them. Now the second day was the day of Noah and his family. And of course, God's seed was in them, and God made a difference between the righteous and the wicked again, didn't he? And then the third day came Abraham, and God made a distinction again between Abraham's son Isaac and Ishmael. God made a division, a distinction between the two, right? And then the true seed, Jesus, came at the end of the fourth day of the 4,000 years. He was the true seed. Amen? And the fifth day, the church began there at Pentecost. And, of course, God is putting His seed in His people, the true seed of Christ. And then we're in the sixth day right now. And back in Genesis, on the sixth day, we know God made the beast and man. And in this hour, we see the beast coming forth, and yet God bringing forth a new man. Isn't that right? In the sixth day. And then, of course, the seventh day will be the millennial reign. Now, from Jesus, Jesus came at the end of what day, did I say? At the end of the 4,000 years, the fourth day, and that leaves how many? To the millennium. 3 days. And you got that? All right. Now, turn to Hosea. Turn to Hosea. Let's look at another scripture here in Hosea about the third day. Then we're going to go back to Exodus. Now, Hosea 6, verse 1. Come, let us return to the Lord, for he hath torn, he will heal us. One thing about it, if the Lord tears you, he'll heal you. Yes. Amen? I mean, if the devil does it, he don't care about, he just wants to see you die and get, you know, whatever can happen to you. But when the Lord tears you, he's going to heal you. He has smitten, he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. There's a reviving coming after 2 days. We're coming close to the end of 2 days, aren't we? From Pentecost. In the third day, he will raise us up. How many can see resurrection life, restoration? And we shall live. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. Praise God, he's going to come to us as the rain, the latter, and the former rain to the earth. Amen? All right, that's enough. I can give you some more. But go back to Exodus chapter 19. Now, we see the Lord told Moses to sanctify the people. How many know we're going to have to be sanctified for the coming of the Lord? Can I show you that in the scripture? Keep your place. Exodus, turn to 1 Thessalonians 5. The Lord just now gave it to me, so we've got to go that way. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Notice what Paul said, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved or kept blameless unto the coming, the parousia of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And without holiness or sanctification, again, we cannot see the Lord. Isn't that right? All right. All right. Back in Exodus, we see the people are to be sanctified. Verse 11 of chapter 19 of Exodus. Notice, be ready against the third day. The third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of the people. They're going to see it. Nothing secret about it. He's going to descend. The people's going to see it. It's going to be the third day. Now, verse 14 of Exodus 19. And Moses went down from the mount to the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. They had clean garments. Do what, Bill? They got rid of the dirt. Hallelujah. He's got some of the dirt off of us in this convention, hadn't he? Verse 15. And he said to the people, be ready against the third day. Come not at your wives. Verse 16, it shall come to pass on the third day. When? In the morning. In the morning of the third day. That's important to see. And I believe the scripture teaches us that Jesus will come at the beginning of the day of the Lord, or at the beginning of that day, 1,000 years. It shall come to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunders and lightning. Yes, sir. That's right. And a thick cloud upon the mount, and the voice of the trumpet. Hallelujah. How many know Paul talked about the trumpet? Zephaniah, Joel, Revelation, many scriptures on the trumpet in the Bible. Isn't that right? But notice here, it says the voice of the trumpet was exceedingly loud. Yes. It'll wake the dead. So that all the people that was in the camp trembled. We're dealing, as Glenn said, the day of the Lord here. The trumpet sounding. God's going to come down. Amen. And he's calling Moses to the top. Moses is the type of God's overcomers, isn't he? And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God. To meet with God. We shall be caught up in the air to what? Meet him where? In the air. And they stood up. Of course, they were at the bottom of the mount. And the Mount Sinai was altogether on smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. And the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mount quaked greatly. Verse 20, and the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mount, and the Lord called Moses up to the top of the mount, and Moses went up. Hallelujah. God's calling us up to the mountain. Amen? Amen. Now turn to Exodus 24. Exodus 24. Verse 10. There are three levels in these verses right here, 30, 60, and 100. Exodus 24, verse 10. He's talking about, in verse 9, he's talking about Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and the elders of Israel, and they saw the God of Israel. And there was under his feet, and we said yesterday that we are the feet, amen? But under his feet there was a paved work. There was a work of a sapphire stone. And as it were, the body of heaven. The body of heaven. It's heaven in a body. Hallelujah. In his clearness, which shows there is no darkness, no shadow of turning. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also they saw God and ate and did eat and drink. That's to us the spirit. I mean, he talks about that over in 1 Corinthians, about eating and drinking. And the Lord said to Moses, come up to me in the mount and be there. Now notice it's a command. Come up to me in the mount and be there. You can't come up unless God brings you up. Isn't that right? And I will give you tables of stone. All right. Moses, in verse 13, rose up, and Joshua, and they go up towards the mountain of God. Hallelujah. Now the elders there in verse 14 were told to tarry behind, so they stopped on a certain level. And then Joshua and Moses go up to the second level. Right? Hallelujah. And verse 15, and Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it. How long? 6 days. What day are we in now? We're in the sixth day. So Moses had to wait 6 days, you see, and the glory of God covered the mount, right? Now, God was preparing Moses in 6 days to hear his voice. Because on the seventh day, he's going to say, come on up, Moses.
Yes.
Can you hear that? And we're in the sixth day. We're in preparation. We're to be ready. Because God's going to say, come on up higher. Amen? And you're going to behold my glory in the seventh day. Hallelujah. And the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And remember, Joshua was staying behind now. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a fire upon the mounts. In verse 18, Moses went into the midst of the cloud and get him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I believe God is calling a people up to behold the glory of God. Amen. But remember, we've got to be sanctified. We've got to be clean. Amen. We've got to wait until God says it's time. Amen. Now, 2 Chronicles 5. 2 Chronicles 5. 2 Chronicles 5. How many know you see Pentecost right here? Verse 12. People that are praising the Lord with their cymbals and the psalteries and harps. And they're standing in verse 12, the latter part of verse 12. They're standing at the east end of the altar. How many know east is when the sun comes up? It's where light is. And they're standing at the altar, the place of separation, sanctification, dedication, sacrifice, worship. And with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. There's your 120 priests, Glenn, with their trumpets. That's Pentecost, amen, here in Chronicles. It came even to pass as the trumpeters and singers were as what?
One.
Yes, sir. As they were one to make one sound. They were all, we would say, saying the same thing. The trumpet speaks of a voice, doesn't it, to us today? Amen. But the sound and one thing, to make one sound, to be heard in praising, thanking the Lord. And then notice when they lift up their voice with the trumpets and the cymbals of music and praise the Lord, saying his good, his mercy endures forever, that then the house. Who's the house today? The house was filled with a cloud. Even the house of the Lord. And here's what I wish to see sometime. You don't need anybody behind here. When this glory comes in. The priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Anybody long to see that?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Well, notice again what it says, that they were one and there was one sound. When we begin to say the same thing, hallelujah, and do the same thing, I believe it's going to happen, don't you? Amen. Turn to Isaiah 52 just a minute. There's a scripture coming to me here. I want to give you along with that particular one scripture there. Isaiah 52. Look in verse 7. Look in verse 7. It says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him. Notice the word him. In Romans it says them. That brings good tidings and publishes peace. That brings good tidings of good. And publishes salvation, that saith to Zion, thy God reigneth. Thy watchman shall lift up the voice with the voice together. Not apart. Shall they sing, for they shall see eye to eye. My margin says, be of one mind. Amen. When the Lord shall bring again Zion. The watchmen of God are going to lift their voice. They're going to sing together. But they're going to see alike. And how many know it says again, without holiness, no man can see the Lord. But I'm thinking of that scripture there in Matthew 5. The pure in heart shall see God. These people are pure in heart because they're going to see with one mind. They're going to see eye to eye. They're going to see the same thing. Can you say amen? All right, so God says he's going to fill the house with the glory. Now, turn to 2 Chronicles 7. 2 Chronicles 7. In God's Word. Hallelujah. In verse 1, and before we read, when Moses reared up the tabernacle, what happened when he finished it? The glory filled it. Now, why did the glory fill it? Because he built it according to the pattern he had seen. And how many know Jesus is the pattern?
Yes.
And when it was built exactly to the pattern, God filled it with his glory. Amen. And we're going to see here that when Solomon reared up the temple, God filled it with his glory. The fire fell. How many know Jesus came and he was the true temple of God? And he had the fullness of the Godhead bodily in him. Amen? But how many know he's bringing forth a people at the end of the age? And he's commanding us to be filled with what? All his fullness. Amen? Now in 2 Chronicles 7 verse 1, when Solomon had made an end of praying, when he got through praying, hallelujah. How many has ever heard people pray, and when they pray, brother, heaven come down? And you hear others pray, and you know, you can just, nothing happens. Amen? When Solomon made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven. Here was a man that prayed. Why? Why did God hear his prayer? Because he did exactly what God had told him to do. But when he prayed, the fire from heaven came and consumed the burnt offering, the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house again. Amen. Now look at verse 2 again. The priest could not enter the house because the glory had filled the house. In verse 3 and down in verse 3, they bowed themselves upon their faces to the ground upon the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord. You know, some people don't believe in miracles. But if they ever feel the touch of fire upon them, I'll tell you what they'll do. They'll fall on their face and worship God.
Right.
Amen. And you don't have to push these people down, brother. They go down.
Right.
Hallelujah. And verse 4, they offered sacrifices. Verse 5, they dedicated the house of God. Verse 6, the priests waited on their offices. They weren't trying to get somebody else's place.
That's right.
They were waiting on their office. Hallelujah. God didn't want us to be like somebody else.
Right.
Be yourself. And fulfill the ministry God has given you and me. Praise the Lord. And they sounded the trumpets in verse 6. Now look at verse 10. In the middle part of verse 10. They went away to their tents glad and merry in heart. But when the fire of God is present, I want to tell you, you'll go home happy. Isn't that right? Let me show you two scriptures here. In 1 Corinthians 11. This may apply to you and me many places where we've been. Not to this camp meeting. But this has happened in my life. 1 Corinthians 11, 17. Turn there with me. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11, 17, now this, in this that I declare to you, I praise you not that you come together not for the better, but for the worse. Amen. You ever went to a meeting and wish you stayed home because you felt worse? Turn to Acts 19. Let me give you one other scripture now. I can find it.
Lord, where's that at?
32. Some therefore cried one thing. Boy, it sounds like today. Some another. For the assembly, the word assembly is church there, ecclesia, was confused, and the more part, the major part, knew not wherefore they were come together.
Anyway, thought I'd throw those in for good measure.
Turn to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation 1, verse 10. I'm going to read from the Amplified Translation. In Revelation 1, 10, John said, I was in the Spirit wrapped, R-A-P-T, wrapped in His power. Wrapped in His power on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice like the calling of a war trumpet. How many's ever heard the war trumpet? What's the war trumpet for? Time for war. Amen. That's really a deep revelation, isn't it? Chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. He said, after this I looked, and lo, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard addressed to me like the calling of a war trumpet said, come up here. That's what Moses heard, wasn't it? Come up here. And I will show you what must take place in the future. And there, people don't think we should teach too much on things, coming events, but I think we should. Amen? But how many know you've got to be in the Spirit and get revelations on those things from the Holy Ghost? Next verse. At once I came under the Holy Spirit's power, and lo, a throne stood in heaven, and one seated on the throne. John's a type, the overcomer. Now, he said, I was... In chapter 1, he said, I was in the Spirit wrapped in His power. Let me tell you what the word wrapped means. It means lifted as by supernatural force. Now, we're not talking about a rapture. We're talking about in the Spirit. John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, didn't he? And but this word wrapped, I looked it up in the dictionary. It means to be lifted up by supernatural force. It means to be transported as in spirit to another place. And it means transported with love and delight. It means to be enraptured. And it means wholly absorbed or engrossed as in a feeling or meditation. And it means to be seized. John was seized in the Spirit. Hallelujah. But what did God say? Come up hither. Come up higher. Now turn to Revelation 11. The sons of God are going to hear the same word. Did you know that? Revelation 11 is the chapter on the two witnesses, which are the sons of God. Now, I'm not going to go into it. I just want to show you the scripture here in the Word of God. Look in verse 11. After 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life from God entered into them. And they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying to them, what? What did it say?
Come up hither.
Come up hither. That's exactly what John heard in Revelation chapter 4. Come up hither. After 3.5 days, and they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. How many know we got some enemies? We got a whole lot of them. They're all around today, aren't they? Our enemy is really not flesh and blood. Amen? Now, we know the enemy uses man. But God, anyway, God said, come up hither. Now, what is the timing here? Look in verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded. There's the trumpet. The seventh message. Amen? And they were called up higher. Hallelujah. Come up hither. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Turn to Haggai, chapter 2. Haggai. We want to look at verse 6, 7, 8, and 9 of Haggai. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. You can go to Hebrews 12, 26 and see that same scripture. Verse 7. And I will shake what? All nations. Does that include ours? All right. And the desire of all the nations shall come, and I will fill this house. Who's the house?
We are. In my Father's house or what? Who's the house? We are. In my Father's church are many abodes or dwelling places. Now, right here, he said, I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. God speaking. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts, and the glory of this latter house shall be greater. What's going to be greater? The glory is going to be greater. Amen. What does that mean? That means there's more glory coming. But when do you get glory? When there is also suffering. Don't shout me down now. I want to show it to you. Go to first, keep your place, 1 Peter. Go to 1 Peter. Have to have a lot of fingers today, don't you? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Look in verse 13. But rejoice, 1 Peter 4:13. But rejoice in so much as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his what? Glory shall be revealed, you may be glad with exceeding joy. Chapter 5, verse 1, the elders which are among you, Peter said, I exhort, who am also an elder. Peter was an elder and a shepherd. And a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. All right, let's go back to Haggai and read a scripture now. Again. In Haggai 2, verse 9, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former. And what else do you think is going to be great? Suffering. Can you understand that? Saith the Lord of hosts, and in this place, in this house, this church, God said, will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. So not only is it going to have the glory of God, it's going to have the peace of God. He is our peace. Amen? Amen. Now, turn to Isaiah 60. Here's a song we sing a lot, don't we? Isaiah 60. I'll just give you a few more scriptures before we close. Hallelujah. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles, the nations, or the heathen shall come to thy light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up thine eyes round about, and see that all they gather themselves together. They come to thee, thy sons shall be come from far. Thy daughters shall be nursed at thy side. Then thou shalt see. The pure in heart shall what? Thou shalt see and flow together. And remember, without a blow, you can't flow. Amen. And thine heart shall fear, be enlarged, because, here's the reason, the abundance of the sea, this is humanity, shall be converted unto thee, and the forces, the wealth of the Gentiles will come to you, church. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? Now look at Matthew 17. Let me give you a couple more scriptures here real quick. In Matthew 17. You could go on and on with this teaching. Now look at the first verse of Matthew 17 after 6 days. Now what comes after six? That's another big revelation. Did everybody get that? After 6 days, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John, his brother, and brings them up into the mountain apart. And, of course, Jesus was transfigured, changed. Before them, his face, of course, did shine as the sun, which also he says that concerning his people in the kingdom in Matthew 13. And his raiment was white as light. Yes. But notice when that happened. It says, after 6 days. And after six is seven. Now turn to Luke 9:28. Luke 9:28. Now look at this. It's a little different, but watch it. And it came to pass about an 8 days after these things. Well, what's about eight? What's about eight? Seven. We're dealing with what? The seventh day. We've seen it in the teaching earlier. About 8 is 7. After 6 is 7. There's no discrepancy of the scripture. It came to pass about 8 days after these things, he took Peter, John, and James and went up into a mountain to pray. And there, of course, he was changed before them because the glory of the Lord was upon him. Amen? Now, I believe that this experience will happen to the sons of God. They will be caught to the throne as a man-child. They will be changed. Now remember, Jesus had this experience and he went down from the mountain and he still laid his life down, didn't he? Amen? And Peter says the day star must what? Arise where? In your hearts. And Peter was talking about the same experience when he mentioned that. So when we think here, we think of the transfiguration, we think of the glory of God in the sons of God. We think of the authority of God that's going to be in those sons in Revelation 11. They've been given authority and they're called up higher, aren't they? Amen? And of course he said the day star's got to come into us, and of course the man child is caught to the throne, which is authority, right? So there's the glory of God, there's the authority of God, there's the throne of God, the light of God. It's all going to be in the sons. But how many know to get there? There's some real overcoming every day. Amen? We're not going to tell you you're there. You get there by letting the overcomer come in you and overcome through you. His name is Jesus. Amen. Now, I want to show you one more scripture before we close. Now, we're talking today about the bosom of the Father, the Holy of Holies, the mountain of God. I think the word is scepter in the Old Testament. But in the spirit, in the secret place, there's many titles. But I want to give you one scripture in Isaiah 56 as we close here. Isaiah 56. How many know that John was taken to a high mountain in Revelation? And when he was taken to a high mountain, he was showed the church. Now, you got to be careful who takes you, because you know it says the devil took Jesus to a high mountain. And remember, Jesus was on a fast. And when you're on a fast, you be careful. Because many people are deceived on fast. Amen. And we all have to be careful, don't we, brethren? We must be careful. Now, in Isaiah 56, look at verse 3, down in the middle part. He says, "The Lord hath utterly separated me from his people, neither let the eunuch say, Behold, I'm a dry tree." Verse 4. "For thus saith the Lord to the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths and choose the things that please me and hold my covenant." In verse 7, God said, "Even them, the eunuchs, will I bring to my what?
Holy mountain.
I will make them joyful in the house of prayer." Now, what's a eunuch? A eunuch is one that cannot bring forth children. He is one that cannot reproduce out of himself. I'm talking spiritually now. He is one that will not dare to reproduce out of himself. How many know that you've got to grow up in the Lord to come to that place? That keep my Sabbath, that do those things that please me. He said, "I'm going to bring them to the high mountain." That's the Holy of Holies. That's Zion. And God wants to bring us to a place, brethren, where it's no longer guesswork. That what we do only by the Spirit. That we're led by the Spirit. And you can only do that as you grow and you learn to discern God's voice from the enemy's voice. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's stand. Hallelujah. We've enjoyed sharing this word today with you. Lord, we just thank you today that you're calling us up higher, Lord. And God, put that desire in each one of our hearts today, Lord, not to lag behind, but to begin to cry out and to seek you with all of our heart, Lord. Lord, daily, Lord, let us hear your voice. Let us be led by thee, Lord. Let us only move as you direct us, Lord. Let us not do anything out of ourselves, Lord. God, let us come to a place where we won't say, do, go, Lord, without the Spirit leading. Oh, Lord, we need your Spirit. We need your direction. And you said, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Father, help us to be led, to know the voice of God. You said, my sheep know my voice. Help us to know your voice, Lord. Lord, keep us from error and deceptions. Keep us, Lord, from any false visitations, any false dreams, false prophecies. Lord, false words of knowledge, false words of wisdom, Lord. Lord, false miracles, false signs, false wonders. Lord, keep us from the false prophets, the false Christ, Lord, and all that's in the church. God, keep us, O God. Protect us, set a wall of fire about us. Cause your angels to be over us, O God, to watch over us, Lord. You said they encamp about those that fear you, Lord. Lord, let us not seek manifestations or signs, but to seek the Lord. God, the signs will follow us as we preach your word, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. God bless you, Brother Miller.
Praise the Lord.
Love you, brother.
Well, I guess all that's left to do is to eat what they've got fixed in there for us, clean up the kitchen. See you next time you can come this away. Amen. The Lord bless you and watch over you as you travel. Amen. The mercy and the glory of the Lord. Amen.
This is the end of this message. Our website is www.LakeHamiltonBibleCamp.com and LHBCOnline.com. There are many hundreds of free audio files there. It's like going to Bible school at home.